I'm so pleased the way the theme went this morning with each speaker that got up sort of bringing it towards what I'm about to preach. And I really feel, not just because of mostly the age of our congregation, but we are in a time that we've got to show the world that Jesus Christ is real and that healing is for us. Healing is for each and every one of us.
Yes.
Healing is a part of the plan of redemption.
Amen.
John 1, 1 to 3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. And we're talking about Jesus. He is the Word. All things were made through him, Jesus, and without him, Jesus, nothing was made that was made. This has been my main focus over this last few weeks, is the Word is Jesus, right in the beginning. So when the Bible was written, we have a book of Jesus. So that's what we choose to believe. Now, there's a time in your life as a Christian you'll have to come to that point. Is the Word true or is the Word not true? And the things you're not sure of and you think, well, perhaps that's not true and this, that and the other, you've got to work at what does the Word of God say about that situation. Now we know healing is for today. And it's not just healing of the body, it's healing of the mind, it's healing of the soul. It's healing, it's a complete package that Jesus got for us on the cross. Now what we're going to try and learn to do is how do we function in that so it's not always a struggle. Now I admit in my own case in some areas if I had been sick or needed health and healing and so forth, it came instantly. And other times it didn't. Other times I seemed to have to work at it and really get back into the Word or spend more time in the Word and really be convinced that God is for me and not against me, particularly as I came from a denomination way back that didn't believe in any of this, didn't believe in healing, didn't believe in prosperity, didn't believe in anything really. And I used to think, well, what's the point? What's the point of going to church if we're not going to learn about how good Jesus is? I'm not here to browbeat you. I'm not here to smack you over the head with a 4-pound Bible and say, oh, you sinners. What I'm here to do is encourage you to walk in Christ, because that's our main thing. God is good. Devil is bad. If we can get that, just that little thing in us, it's so important. Jesus purchased our health and our diseases. The word dis-ease. Dis-ease. In other words, if it's not ease, it's dis-ease. Now, I was thinking a little while back too, I said, okay, God, if that works, I understand diseases, you know, like cancers and all those sort of flus and all these things that have little microbe things and bacteria that go through your body. I can understand that is dis-ease. But what about like when I put my back out? Does that come under what Jesus purchased on the cross? The more I thought about it, and the more I looked at it, I thought, dis-ease. This back is causing me dis-ease. So it must be covered on the cross. See, some things like you're working and you put your leg out or your back out or something goes out, a muscle goes out. Okay, it might be due to a lack of exercise or that you suddenly wanted to do something like I put my back out by doing some heavy lifting that I shouldn't have done. I knew I shouldn't, but I still went ahead and did it, and I suffered the consequences. But that doesn't change that Jesus looks at that and he doesn't say, "You twat, you fool, I'm not going to heal you." Now, it's I can still reach out. My youth is renewed like the eagles. That's what the Bible says. My youth is renewed like the eagles. So I expect my back to be healed. So Jesus purchased our health and our diseases because they were laid on him. Now, I know that sounds like, wow, this is so incredible what it is. But our little minds try to comprehend it. Try to comprehend the cross, what Jesus purchased for us. We can't. We just have to do the best we can. But the Bible says that all sickness and disease was laid on Jesus. All sin was laid on Jesus, and through his suffering, and then the price was paid, and that he rose again, and that means that we are in the New Testament. We are a new creation in Christ. Old things have passed away. I don't mean that as myself. One day I'm going to pass away. I'm talking about old things have passed away, okay? Let's look at Hebrews 9, verse 24. For Christ has not entered the holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Not that he should offer himself often, as the high priest enters the most holy place every year with the blood of another. He then would have had to suffer often since the foundation of the world, but now, once at the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. He's put away sin. So sin can never become a question of a hindrance in your life to receive healing. Okay, obviously, if you're... I don't want to go down that track. You know what I'm saying? Sin has been dealt with on the cross. So we can walk in that freedom even when we mess up, and we know we get that inner feeling, hey, we shouldn't be doing this, then the repentance means we'll stop doing it and change your mind and do the right thing. Simple as that. That's all repentance is. Repentance is so easy. Just saying, oh, sorry, Lord, I missed that. I'll do my best not to do that again. You see, we are so sin conscious. We're brought up that way. We're so, like even it came out this morning, what is your natural response? Is it negative? The phone goes off in the middle of the night. What is your first thought? Somebody's ringing to bless me. Yeah, wrong number. That's a good one. Actually, that's one of the better ones. If you've got a lot of teenagers, then you'll have all sorts of thoughts before you get to the phone. And isn't it silly when the phone rings? What is your statement? I wonder who that is. Well, when you pick up the phone, you will find out. But as you know, we do such weird things. I wonder who that is. Pick the phone up and you'll find out. Simple as that. So sin is dealt with in the spirit and the soul. Everyone believe that. Even the sin that's in our senses. Quite often the word flesh is used in the Bible, but I think, you know, from what I've been reading over quite some time now, it's the word flesh would be better interpreted senses. We live in our senses. Everything we do, we live in our senses. Every addiction, every craving, everything is living in our senses. Is that right? We live in our senses, whether we like it or not. But it can be changed when we're drawn more to what God is saying about it. Yeah, I was thinking about this too. You know, this isn't the Bible. We are ambassadors for Christ. Have you ever, when you read that scripture, an ambassador is somebody who represents their country in the fall. An ambassador that's living overseas lives in a building, in a compound or whatever, and that is regarded, even though it's a, say like America has got an embassy somewhere, say in Syria, even in Syria or places like that, that is actually regarded as American soil. You're not allowed to go on that without their permission, without the ambassador's permission. That land in another country is actually given to the host, to the country that sent it. So they represent Christ. Okay, we see lots of movies where those people are violating it. They're attacking the embassy. something's happened, so they attack the embassy. That is a violation. And we've got to see that violation as the same thing as when sickness and disease attacks our body. That's a violation. That should not be allowed, and we're the ones have to put our hands up and say that. The word says, and this is what I choose to believe, that by his stripes I'm healed. Now, the other day I was just flicking through some things, and I thought I'd just listen to part of a sermon from somebody else. And, you know, I like to know what's going on sometimes, and I shouldn't have done. And I heard him say, there's several times, I'm not going to tell you who, it's not important, but I'm trying to find out, you know, I want to see this church full. We are preaching the gospel that will give you hope, will give you a way out of situations. But the theme of this was, God knows your situation. And he kept on about God knows your situation, everything, God knows your situation. But not once did he say, but God will help you out of that situation. He was saying that somebody in the congregation was seriously ill, that was in a coma in church, in the hospital. And all that was said was, God knows her situation. And I thought, okay, God knows the situation. Now, what's the way out? I mean, would you like me just to say, God knows your situation? Would that encourage you? God knows your situation. God does know your situation. There's no doubt about that. But the Bible tells you if it's a situation you need to get out of, he shows you a way to get out of it. Amen. And that's where, when you hear things like this, it takes the fight out of you because you become a little bit caesar up. Whatever will be. And that can be changed because of what the word says.
Amen.
Whatever situation is, it's subject to change. Just got to hang in there sometimes. Things don't always go as fast as we like. Have you noticed that?
Yes.
God doesn't seem to be in a hurry. And I remind him quite frequently about that. So it's all right for you. You live forever. I'm only here for a short time. You don't speak to him like that? Okay. Well, yeah. When you get frustrated, sometimes you do. You know, you say, well, I'm only here for a short time. So, you know, let the blessings flow. let things happen.
Amen,
you know?
Pastor.
Amen.
I don't want to be like this forever. It's a similar thing to the police. The police are given a badge. They're given an authority. Sometimes they're given a uniform, but it's really the badge that is the thing. Because of the detectives and so forth, they go around and they flash the badge. That's their authority to say, hey, Kat, I can arrest you. I can put you in prison. I can take you anyway before the judge. But have you ever noticed that we don't have many of them, well, we don't see much of it here. In other countries, they have police that stand and direct traffic. You ever seen that on the things where they put their hand up and that car should stop? That truck should stop. It's only a little person with a badge or a uniform. And that's how the devil sometimes will have a go. He says, just go for you, and doesn't stop. But we have the badge of life. We can hold up, Jesus is my Lord.
Amen.
And we can stop the onslaught that comes against us.
Yes.
Just through the name of Jesus. That strengthens us to know that when we use the name of Jesus, things have to change.
Amen.
Subject to change. If you're a person that gets into depression quite easy, start to think on the good things that you have in life. And if you don't think you have good things in New Zealand, I don't care how bad it is in New Zealand, you want to think about what it's like in other countries. Have you ever watched documentaries like in India where people literally live in the dump, just searching for plastic bottles and this, that and the other? That's how they live day to day. No shoes, and they're walking amongst all these syringes and all this sort of thing. We can glorify God. I can't understand why anyone in this nation would want to commit suicide, because we have so much. We have so much compared to other nations.
Amen.
Yeah, when I went to Vietnam, I could not believe that it was a culture shock. You see it on TV, but when you're amongst it, When you see it like that, you realize, wow, we are so truly blessed.
Amen, Pastor.
We went to the hospital because that's where Ralph and Linda with Vietnam Outreach involved in doing all these operations, and it was their week to hire the hospital. So every day we went to the hospital, and what shocked me was the conditions that these people have as a hospital. Even the sheets were filthy. Now, we would have them changed every 2 or 3 days or every day if there was sickness or disease, wouldn't we? They had 2 to a bed, and the families were sleeping on the floor in the ward. The biggest thing that hit me, well, after that, no air conditioning. The place was like an oven. It was like an oven. And you know, under Vietnam Outreach, they have never lost a person in any of those operations. They all were healed. I mean, I'm talking about hundreds and hundreds of operations, never lost one person. And they had some of them quite serious because they were doing burn operations as well. But mainly it was cleft palate, which was the result of Agent Orange during the Vietnam War. And so all these children are born with these defects. And Ralph and Linda felt particularly drawn to fund and to help. And we're part of that. We give to that as well. And it's interesting that, see, in our culture, somebody has a cleft lip, you know, what I mean, a twisted, scarred lip. We would accept them. We wouldn't see them as an outcast. But in their culture, they became an outcast. And so trying to live that way. So giving an operation not only changed their physical appearance, but it also changed their standing in the community. And particularly the women ended up getting married, and whereas they could never get married before because of these serious things. But it intrigued me that how blessed we are, and we don't even realize it. I saw the cart. I said, what's that cart for? They said, that cart goes out every morning and picks up the dead people around the hospital. I was literally in shock. I said, well, how come they're dead? How come they're not being helped? They said, well, by the time they get to the hospital, they're too far gone to be helped. And so they won't even bother with them. They feed them outside sort of thing, but they're living the outside until they die. Wouldn't that be heartbreaking? People die with nobody there, with a handout to just be with them. Wouldn't that be a lonely way to die? We are so blessed, aren't we? We don't even realize it. Romans 8, verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Who's in Christ Jesus? We're all in Christ Jesus, right? So there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, according to the senses. Makes more sense, doesn't it? Because flesh, what is, a lot of people, when you say the word flesh, they immediately think of the sexual sins or the sexual side of it. It's not. The flesh is the five senses. The five senses that is our communication through our body, isn't it? Taste, smell, touch, and the other two. Who do not walk according to the senses, but according to the Spirit. That's the recreated Spirit. That's the born again, recreated, and also renewed Spirit. The more you renew your Spirit, the more you get in charge of your senses. Because the more you renew, the more you know about Christ, the more power it seems to empower you more to know, hey, God loves me so much that I will overcome this particular area in my life. Is that right? We all have problems. There's not one person here that hasn't got a problem somewhere. If you are, come up here and I'll sit down there. What you see in others as a weakness could be a strength in you, but it also can be the other way around. So don't ever judge people either for what they're going through. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me what?
Free.
free from the law of sin and death. We've got to treat sin and disease in the same way. Did you hear that? Got to treat sin and disease as the same way. It is not to be tolerated in our lives. And because we're forgiven of sins, then also there's nothing to stop us being healed. You don't qualify by being so good that then that's how God will heal you. God heals you the same way as you are forgiven of all your sins. You do not walk in condemnation. You are free from sin. So therefore, you should be free from sickness and disease, which is in our body, which is the same thing. One is a sickness. Sin is in the soul or the spirit, where disease is in the body. And both have been taken to the cross, and both have been dealt with. All we have to do is work inside us in the area of I choose to believe. I choose to believe. And then just think about those words. We are so blessed to have a Bible. The early Christians did not have a Bible. That's why God did so many signs and wonders around them, because he wanted them to see, hey, I am God. I am the God whom you have chosen to serve. When I say serve, you know what I'm saying. So Romans 1. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, through the senses, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on the account of sin. He condemned sin in the senses. Okay? That the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the senses, but according to the Spirit. Wow. Okay, let's look at Isaiah 53. We all know this one. And most of the things I talk about, you already know. But every so often, you need to have it spoken out again so that you grab hold of it.
Yes.
I mean, it's no different to a meal, is it? You can't say, well, I had a meal last Thursday, so I'll be right now until the next one next week. No, it's exactly the same. That's how your soul and spirit have to be fed by the word of God to keep it up. Because negatives come in. Negatives from the world just come. You look at the news, it's negative, negative, negative. From every angle. And so how can we overcome that? We know who we are in Christ. When I die, I know I go to heaven. You say, how can you be that assured? Because of what the word says.
Amen.
There's no other, that's what I believe. Because I have received Jesus. Now the other things I'm still working on is seeing more and more people healed, more and more people walking in that freedom, walking in the prosperity God has given us. See, God allows us to be prosperous so that we can become bigger givers, not to get a bigger house. Nothing wrong with a bigger house, but the whole purpose is. I mean, you bring that in perspective. If a person's got so much wealth and they're giving a percentage, where a person has got very little and still gives, then the blessings will flow both ways from God. All right? It says, give and it shall be given unto you. It's not how much you give, it's how much it means to you. How much you're willing to say, I trust you, God. Okay, he is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and had carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was
wounded.
He was, he is, he has. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement for our peace was upon him, and the one we love to say, and by his stripes we are healed, and we walk in that divine health. You cannot separate sin and disease, the disease problem. They are together, but they have both been done on the both been fixed on the cross. We're set free. There was no disease until sin came. And sin is breaking the law, isn't it? It is the law of the body, it culminates in disease. It is the law of the spirit, it culminates in sin. Now I want to really blow some myths that are still floating around the church. I was surprised, you know, we've been around quite some time now, and we've grown in the things of God. We've literally turned our back on some of the things that we were taught. Some of the things have had to change because through revelation of God's word and through by asking God, hey, this doesn't feel right to me. Can you show me the truth? Over the years, we've had to change things, but I'm still surprised. It's like, well, we've changed over these 30 years. How come this stuff is still being preached, even in our city? How come these lies are still being, these myths of who God is and what God can do? Okay. The myth to be blown. God only heals by a special act of grace. Is that true or false?
False.
Totally false. And yet many people think that. Otherwise, if you look at that and say, God only heals by the special act of grace, then why is the Bible written the way it is? It says Jesus is the same today, yesterday, and forever.
Hallelujah.
The Bible also says that he's no respecter of persons.
That's right.
But somehow some person gets healed. I don't know how it happens. That's between them and God. And they say, oh, you know, that was an act of grace. But Sister so-and-so over here, oh, you know, she died. That's because God didn't have an act of grace towards her. And they say, and this is how the act of grace happens. It's only faith as a gift from God. Does your Bible say that? I heard this just recently. That you only be healed if God gives you the faith to believe as a gift. I mean, there is the gift of faith, and so that's where they take it from. But they're saying, only faith will be released through the grace of God for you to be healed. True or false? Another myth. Blown out the door. And this is happening in our city right now. This is what's being said. And what does the Bible say?
By his stripes we are healed.
By his stripes we are healed. It also says faith comes by
hearing.
Hearing and hearing and hearing. Not hearing if God's going to give me grace, but hearing what his grace is in the word of God. And his grace is that we walk in that divine health. Is that right? But we've got to put the effort in. You know, it's not, but it's, when I say put the effort in, it's not by works. In fact, it's almost the opposite. It's resting in the fact we know his word is true.
Amen.
Isn't that exciting?
Amen.
It comes by resting. You get rest when you utterly believe something. When you truly believe beyond all doubt, like Doresh was saying, if you believe that my God shall supply all my needs, and you look at the bank account, it doesn't look too good. But you, in your heart, you're not in fear. You're not going, oh, I'm going to go to the bank and get another 20% loan and all this sort of stuff. Or use my credit card at 24% interest. No, you can trust the Lord. You know you can trust the Lord because he says he shall supply all your needs. Sometimes there is a little gap. And as I say, sometimes it's like God seems to be the last minute. But I have learned that he's never out of coming the right time.
That's right.
But it appears to us. I mean, many people say, if it's not happened by such and such a date, this is what I'm going to do. Don't do that. Stick to your original plan. That if what God says in his word is true, then hang in there.
Amen.
And get rid of fear by reading the word of God.
Amen.
So you get rid of fear. I heard it said just recently, read the four Gospels if you're looking for healing. Just read the four Gospels over and over and over again, and you read about all the miracles that Jesus did. And you don't hear one single time where Jesus had to qualify people, they received their healing. And that was really still under the Old Testament, really, wasn't it? They received his healing because Jesus had been anointed by the Holy Ghost. So he was operating not out of his deity, he was actually operating out of his humanity. He was showing us that when we're anointed with the Holy Ghost, we can do the same as he could. So sometimes we put it into the, oh, Jesus just operated out of his deity. No, he didn't. Because he was anointed by the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost is for us as well. See, they should empower us and say, right, I'm going to start laying hands on the sick and I shall see them recover. You say, oh, well, I don't know. I prayed for a few and they haven't. Well, keep on praying because something will click. Something will happen. People will start getting healed. I remember a guy saying he read in the Bible, it was, his name was Gore, I can't remember his first name.
Prince.
Hmm?
Chris Gore,
yeah, thanks. Chris Gore. We had a meal with him when we were at Bethel many years ago. And I said to him, you know, how does it work that, you know, you prayed for so many people and they didn't get healed? What kept motivating you to keep on praying for people, laying hands on them? Because he would go out on crusades and all sorts of things. He said, there was only one thing that motivated me. He said, what the Word of God said. And he said, it literally was nearly 1,000 people. He said, I reckon I prayed for 1,000 people. Saw some healing, saw some things happen. And he said, but after those 1,000, something started to happen on the inside of me. God empowered me because of what I chose to believe. And more people started getting healed in his ministry. But he persisted. He was like, oh, that didn't work. Give that up. You don't do that. You just keep on pushing through. And then the anointing comes upon you to see more breakthrough in those things. Is that right?
Amen.
His sovereign grace gives faith. To me, that's hit and miss. It gives you no fight. You've got to know that God is for you and not against you. So these are myths. Your faith can be gained by the renewing of your spirit and building yourself up and reading the Word. And you don't. The sovereign grace is in the Word for every believer.
Amen.
It's not just for a selected few. Some believe too that disease is a disciplinary action. I still hear that. Well, you must have sin in your life, brother, that you're sick. How can you bring Jesus down in 2,000 years to the level of what he first did to where we are now, and dare to say something like that? It's an insult to Jesus of what he did on the cross. In fact, it's a disgrace. It should not be ever spoken in church that way. The church of the devil, it's not a church of God. Giving more emphasis on the devil, that the God, there is no sickness in God, is there?
That's right.
There's no sickness in heaven.
Amen.
What's our job? To bring heaven to earth. That's our job. So we should be walking in that divine health. Is that right?
Amen.
It takes it puts our faith really in just a sense knowledge. Well, I believe it if I see it. Well, if you see it, you don't really need to believe it because it's already there. And that's how many people are, like Thomas. Thomas was like that, wasn't he? Unless I see it, I will not believe it. What did Jesus say to the people? Blessed are those who believe of what the Word of God said and what I did, rather than their senses. See, it's still a sense thing. I'll only believe it if I see it. Oh, you don't need any faith for that. Anyone can do that. That's not hard to do, is it? If I see it, I believe it. Where's the faith? Calling those things that be not as though they were is the key and the answer to walking in Christ. Calling those things that be not. Calling those things that be not. You call yourself into what the Word of God says to see your breakthrough. Isn't that exciting? Psalm 107, verse 20. We all know this one, but it's such an awesome one. He sent his word. Who's his word?
Jesus.
He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destruction. He delivered us from our destruction. He did it. John 5, verse 30. Oh, I didn't give you that one, did I?
It's there, Pastor, it's there.
You know why I didn't give it to you?
It's there.
On the side of the page. Sorry about that. That was not your fault. Okay. I cannot myself do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is righteous, because I do not seek my own will, but the will of the Father who sent me. That's Jesus speaking. He sought the will of the Father. And what was the will of the Father? What did Jesus do? He went about healing all who were sick.
That's right.
There was only one instance where he could do no miracles, was in his own town, where people said, oh, he's a carpenter. We don't believe he can do this. So things didn't happen. Everywhere where people believed, even when their belief was so small, they were healed. They were healed. They were set free.
Amen.
Can we look at Hebrews 13:8? I don't need to look it up. Jesus Christ, because I've already said it, but this is Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He just did his Father's will. Jesus said he's the same today, yesterday, today, and forever. He said that he did the Father's will. You just read that. He did the Father's will, and the Father's will is for us to walk in divine health. God didn't change. Okay, let's finish on Romans 10. Verse 5. Caught you out again, I know that.
It's coming. Stab us.
Hope this is inspiring you.
Yes.
Don't let that deadness get around your spirit where you just think, oh, perhaps it's not God's will. If we read the word, it is God's will. It's God's will that none should perish.
Yes.
But it gives everyone the free choice. Everyone has free choice. But his actual desire is that none would perish. That's his desire. That's why he gave us free choice. Do we see that?
Yes.
It's his desire. Well, Moses writes about the righteousness which is of the law. The man who does those things shall live by them. You want to live by the law? Then that's how things will happen. But the righteousness of faith speaks in this way. Do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is, to bring Christ down from above. Or, who will descend into the abyss? That is, to bring Christ up from the dead. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Now, unfortunately, with the English language, there's so many things that are not quite right. And the word actually saved means sozo, which we used to speak a lot about. Zozo, you know, you're saying sozo to people. Nothing missing, nothing broken. But zozo means health, wholeness, completeness. It's not just, oh, I'm saved, I'm going to heaven. It actually means completeness in him. Everything that Christ has been made available to us is for us. All we've got to do is partake. Is that right?
Amen.
You are a new creation. You are delivered from Satan's authority.
Amen.
You are a new creation. You've been delivered from Satan's authority. His authority was disease and sickness, poverty, all those horrible things. But we can be delivered from them.
Amen.
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 Saved. Zosa. Nothing missing, nothing broken. Wholeness. Okay, can we please stand? I hope you got something out of this morning. It's my passion to talk about the things and the healing of the living God, because I see so many people are suffering from that. And I know God is a healer. I know everything doesn't come instantly. I know everything doesn't come quickly. But one thing I do know, it does come.
Yes.
It does come. Because the Word of God says it. So Father, we just thank you for this day. And right now, Lord, we would just release the revelation of Christ to rise up on the inside and not allow the devil to push us around anymore. We take that authority through the name of Jesus. Zozo, nothing missing in my life and nothing broken. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And just remember as you go out of that door that is your mission field. And our desire is to see this church filled